Now, it's my distinct honor to introduce Charlotte Danielson, who is our keynote speaker for day two and a dear friend to TeachGate. Professionally, she's been known by many titles. She started as an economist, then teacher. She worked as an administrator, a researcher. Many know her as an author, certainly a consultant, an entrepreneur, and really, I think today, America's foremost thought leader in the area of professional learning for educators. She leads the Danielson Group out of Princeton, New Jersey, where her team of professionals work with LEAs and SEAs stateside in a number of countries across the globe. And their mission is to develop a school culture of professional inquiry among educators through a systematic examination of their own practice. And that's just right at the heart of what we do at TeachScape as well. We're honored to have been partnering with her on the MET project. And again, working with her, it's just cemented this shared vision of the important work that you all are doing in districts. And we just are thrilled to be able to link arms with her and to be there to support you in that journey. So would you please join me in a warm welcome for Charlotte Danielson.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Is this working? Excellent. Here we go. It's a treat to be here, of course. I mean, who wouldn't want to come to San Diego, as for starters? But it's really a treat, and it's really a treat to have conversations, formal, informal, you know, on the fly with so many of you. So I'm really enjoying it, and I'm learning a lot, of course. Today we're focusing on the framework for teaching as a tool for professional learning. And many of you, of course, know that it's used a lot for teacher evaluation. And so part of our challenge is to marry those functions. But I'd like to just start off with a quick show of hands. Let's see, I'm just trying to gauge the familiarity with the framework. So, so how many people have heard of it? Okay. How many people have given it the thumb test, sort of looked through it? How many people have actually got a working knowledge of it? And if you're using it in your state or district or something, let's see hands. Okay, some. Good. Okay. But I just don't want to bore people, but it gives me an idea of what you know. We've heard some from several speakers about the acknowledging of the complexity of teaching. And I'd like to show you one of my favorite illustrations of this, which is Lee Shulman's comment, where he says, now let's see, what do I have to point this at? Oh, I did it. Yay. Technology, you know, this is why we have kids, right? Okay, so let me just read this. Well, let's read this together because I think it's really fabulous. He says, after 30 years of doing such work, I've concluded that classroom teaching is perhaps the most complex, most challenging, and most demanding, subtle, nuanced, and frightening, I love that, activity that our species has ever invented. The only time a physician could possibly encounter a situation of comparable complexity would be in the emergency room of a hospital during or after a natural disaster. I mean, actually think about it. Doctors see their patients one at a time. We don't get to do that, right? We see them. And one of our challenges, I think, as educators is to remember that each of those 27 people is an individual learner. And in fact, if I could wave a wand and change teacher preparation programs, it would be to require students of teaching, to tutor an individual student for an entire year while they're in training. Because I think we lose sight of the fact that we have individual learners here. And I think if students of teaching had that firm reminder, it would, you know, it would be good. Let me just say one quick thing about the slides. I've changed the order a little bit, and I've added a few. So what you have on your zip drive isn't actually quite what I've got. I mean, everything you've got there I'm using, I just added some. So just wanted to warn you. And this was in a different place. Okay. So let's talk together for a minute about what the framework is used for. It's used in all these ways: teacher preparation, supervising student teachers and so on, recruitment, hiring, mentoring, PD, and evaluating teacher performance. Now, I think it's an interesting sort of exercise to think about how these different things are related to each other. Now, I still haven't figured this out. I don't know where I pointed. There. Maybe there. I don't know. I mean, usually you point it to a computer, right? Anyway, okay, so here are these different things that happen in schools, and they are discrete things. They tend to have their own timelines. They tend to have their own people in charge of them. If there's money involved, they have their own budgets, right? And so they tend to be separate. But if they are all informed by a single definition of good teaching, now my personal favorite being the framework for teaching, but I mean, really, it could be any, and if they are then suspended, that is, what you end up then is with a coherent approach to teacher quality. And so when teachers are hired, for example, you can incorporate questions to do with their performance on things in the framework, or you can analyze a videotape that way of their teaching. And the PD they do can be related to the needs that are identified through the mentoring program and so on. And so it's unified and coherent. And I do recommend that. Now, I've been asked for a long time, people say, well, this framework is pretty cool. We'd like to do it. But where should we start? And what I've actually discovered is that you can start anywhere. Oh, now you see, I've messed this up again. Oh, well. Oh, there we go. I didn't think I touched it. My hero. What? All right, what's the story?
That advances slides. That'll take them back.
Yeah, except it doesn't.
Is it not going back, guys? Let's get
no.
It right for her. Is that advanced?
No, that's advanced.
We're going to get it right for you. Can we just do a quick check? Is that going back?
Not yet.
Do you have another one? No? Sorry, guys. I want to get it right for you.
I appreciate that.
Can we come up with some quick thing? They can do it back there. Can you?
Well, all right, I'll just signal. Go back. One more. Okay, we can do it this way. Oh, man. Where are my kids when I need them? Okay. What I really wanted to say here, I'm just going to put it down. How's that? People say, where do we start? And what I've discovered is that it actually doesn't matter. Because wherever you start, you tend to end up at the same place. That is, suppose you say, well, let's do mentoring. Let's organize our mentoring program around the framework for teaching. And you do that, and then you discover that, oh, if we're mentoring teachers, our new teachers, using this framework, then it would make sense that they be evaluated according to the same framework. And actually, it would make sense that when we recruit and hire, we're actually looking for the same things, etc. And so what I've actually concluded is that no matter which door you go through, you end up in the same place. And what that means to me is that you go through whatever door is open. And it could be that your mentoring door is open. You've got a bunch of money to use for mentoring. You'd go there. Or your school board might be saying, we need to do something about teacher evaluation. We start there. But you end up then backing up into a mentoring program, PD, and so on. So so I think what you're after here, at least what I'm after, is a coherent and unified approach to teacher learning and teacher development, and the framework can provide a structure for that. But I want to focus for a moment now on one important application. You take that one?
Sorry.
It's got big letters on it. I think they knew who they were dealing with. Okay, so let's focus for a moment now on teacher evaluation, because that is, in truth, what many people use my framework for. And in fact, I got a phone call or an email, maybe a letter. Remember letters? We used to do letters from a large urban district when my first edition of the book was first out. And they said, we want to revise our evaluation system, and we'd like to base it on the framework, and they wanted my permission. And now, mind you, their evaluation system really needed revising. It was top-down, punitive, arbitrary, sort of gotcha. So anyway, so they asked my permission. I said, sure, just say where you got it. Not everybody does that. And so they did. They revised it, and they based it on my framework. And you know what? The new system was top-down, arbitrary. That is, all they did was exchange one set of evaluative criteria for another. They did nothing to change the culture around evaluation. Nothing. And of course, my name was all over the darn thing. The only reason I found out about it was I got a phone call from National Public Radio. Now, I'm such an NPR junkie, I recognized Claudio Sanchez as a voice on my phone before he even said his name. And he, you know, I mean, it was causing an uproar, and it was right to cause an uproar because it was still a terrible system. That's when I learned it's not enough to have a good framework. That's merely the beginning to have a good evaluation system. And like in a classroom, many at least, of the really important things that happen there have to do with culture. So they do in the school community. So they do in the school community. And so if we have a punitive and arbitrary attitude towards evaluation, it will poison the relationships. So with all that in mind then, I'd like to focus for a moment, it worked, on evaluation. And let's step back for a second and inquire, why do we even do it? And you might say, well, we've got laws. Oh, okay, right, we do. That moves the question, why do we have laws? Well, for two main purposes, quality assurance and because we care about learning, professional learning. So let's think about these a little bit one at a time. In my view, quality assurance is a non-negotiable. That is, we're public schools, we take public money, the public has a right to expect good teaching. Simple as that. Actually, in private schools, it's worse. They take your money directly, right? But we're public institutions. So we have to be able to ensure good teaching. A superintendent has to be able to say to his community and his board at any moment, everybody who teaches here is good, and here's how I know. We need a system that lets that happen, okay? But in addition to that, we care about learning. And we want to have a system that does both. And when I say, and I think other people, that we want a system that will result in professional learning, this is not because I regard teaching as poor quality that has to be fixed. That's not it. That's not it actually at all. It is that teaching is so hard that it's never perfect. Pretty much by definition. Any lesson, no matter how brilliant, could be a bit better. Which means then, if we accept that, that it is a part of the ongoing responsibility of every teacher to be engaged in a career-long quest for improvement. That becomes then a critical element of the culture of the school around professional inquiry. This is something we all do. Okay? Now, we should say just a couple more things about this, which is that you might look at these, anybody would, and say, well, you know, it's good. We should try to do both of these things. But you know what? They're very different kinds of things. And indeed, they are. A system that ensures quality must be robust. It must be valid. It must be reliable. It must be defensible, professionally defensible, possibly even legally defensible. A lot of hard-sounding things. Whereas a system to promote learning is likely to be more collegial, more collaborative, sort of softer. Right? So the question is then, well, how on earth do you combine them? Now, as a profession, we have a history of trying to combine them, by enhancing the skills of the people who do the evaluating through things like clinical supervision, cognitive coaching, et cetera. And those are fine. I just don't think they're sufficient. I think the key to merging these aims is in the design of the systems themselves. That is, we need systems that promote, that ensure quality, and through the methods they use, promote learning. Seems to me that's, now, I'll just remind us all that of these two, our public, therefore school boards, therefore legislators, they care only about the first. And I'll be honest with you, as a parent, I care only about the first. I actually don't care much that a certain teacher will be good next year. My kid's in there now. I mean, it's got to be good. Well, actually, let's frame this a little differently. It's got to at least be good enough. Well, what's that mean? I think it entails answering four questions. How good is good enough? Good enough at what? How do we know? And who should decide? I mean, the ideas here are actually pretty simple. Now, the doing is not, but the concepts are not complicated. How good is good enough? Good enough at what? How do we know? That's the evidence question. And who should decide? And I'll say one more thing before moving on off of this, and that is that of these two purposes, our current evaluation systems actually don't achieve either one, if we're honest, right? There are, thankfully, only a few, but there are, all of us have known a few teachers who should not still be teaching and who continue to get satisfactory evaluations year after year, and there's been reports on that now. And we also know that nobody learns a darn thing from it. Now, why should they? Let me remind you of something else. Let's say I'm the teacher and you're the evaluator. Here's how a typical observation evaluation system works. You come to my class, you watch me teach. You take notes, you go away, you write up your notes, you come back, you tell me about my teaching. Who's doing the work? What am I doing? Zip. Oh, well, I'm teaching my class. I am under contract to do that. But for this process, what am I doing? Nothing. So, oh, and actually it gets worse. Let's say we meet up in your office afterwards to talk about this lesson. I know that all I have to do is endure that. You will eventually stop talking. And I can leave. So I'd like to just put out a general proposition. And there's actually a lot of research for this. But it sounds so dumb, I hesitate to even say it, but I will. Actually, there's two dumb-sounding things. One is that if we're serious about professional learning, first of all, professional learning is learning. It seems rather obvious and tautological, right? And what that means is, though, we can apply everything we know about learning to it. And what is the main thing we know about learning? This is where it starts sounding really dumb. Learning is done by the learner through an active intellectual process. Period, full stop. And if that's all we know about learning, that'll take us a long way. I'll say it again because it's really central. Learning is done by the learner through an active intellectual process. Now, that applies to students, too, of course. But right now, we're talking about teacher learning. And so an evaluation system in which I, as a teacher, do nothing, should we be surprised that teachers don't learn from that? Well, no. It's exactly what we should expect. Exactly. OK, so let's press on a little bit. Now, a system for quality assurance has to have some elements. There's got to be a clear definition of teaching, the what. And let's just linger here for a sentence or two. I still remember when I was first teaching, I think it was maybe fifth or sixth grade class, I was introducing a new science unit, and on buoyancy and density. Okay, interesting topic, actually, sort of related to sinking and floating, but more advanced and good for fifth and sixth graders. And the kids had pushed their desks together and made tables, and on each table we had a tub of water, sort of like a dishpan size, you know. Now, I don't need to tell you, I was never the most popular teacher with the custodial staff. I mean, things kept happening in my room. But never mind. On this day, kids had... Now, each child had a lump of clay, a little, you know, plasticine ball of clay. And we had a pan balance in the class. They had weighed them. They were satisfied they were roughly the same mass. And so they put them in the water, and of course they sank. Now, their challenge was to make them float, which they discovered they could do if they made it into a boat shape. And then they, and so that was pretty exciting. But then immediately they took it to the next challenge, which was, can they make a good boat? And good, they defined as a boat that would hold a lot of cargo in the form of paper clips. That's what we had available. So they were exploring questions like, should it have thin sides or thick sides? Thin, right? Gives you more enclosed space for the same amount of clay. Should it be shaped more like a bowl or more like a canoe? Bowl, canoes are for rapids, and so on. They got really good. And so they were drawing pictures on the board of their designs and how many paper clips they would hold. And so here was one that held 12 before it sank. Here's 21. They got up over 50. So, now, and then of course, the next days we were getting into displacement and more typical sort of treatments of the concepts around displacement and buoyancy. But while they were in the middle of this exploration, the principal turned up at the door to do an observation, clearly unannounced. He took one look at this scene, and he said, he pulled me aside, he said, "I'll come back when you're teaching." Now, you've probably got similar, well, actually, I hope you don't have similar stories. Now, this is an important little story because I had no idea what he was looking for, what he thought was good teaching. All I knew was that whatever he thought good teaching was, it wasn't this. That's not a lot to go on, but it was better than nothing. But, I mean, so the point was we had no common understanding of a definition of teaching. And the sad part, in that school, in that district, I never did know. I never did know. And he had his own idiosyncratic notion of good teaching, and I've heard people say, oh, I can't tell you what good teaching is, but I sure know it when I see it. Really? Then tell me. You know? So, I mean, we can do a lot better. So, okay, clear definition. Did that work? Yeah. Instruments and procedures that provide evidence of the teaching. That is, what is it that we ask teachers to do? Oh, by the way, let me say one more quick thing about the definition of teaching. I'm well aware that in many places, and it's becoming ubiquitous, I regret to report, but you know this, that part of the definition of teaching is also, people are demanding that it include measures of student learning. And that is, the work I've done is in teacher practice, but there's also a whole parallel universe going on about the results of teachers' efforts. I'm not going to get into that little debate today. I just want you to know I'm aware of it. And I'm struggling with it like everybody else. I don't think there's anybody on the planet who's figured it out, by the way. I get phone calls pretty much daily, at least weekly, from policy people all over saying, what do you recommend we do? And I have to say, well, get back to me in 6 months. Maybe I'll have a clue by then. But I really don't. So just so you know, I'm well aware of the debate, and I don't have any magic answers to it. I don't think we have the psychometric tools, frankly, to do it well. But that's an aside. So let's carry on about evaluating teacher practice, which is where I have put some energy. So instruments and procedures that provide evidence. What do we ask teachers to do? That all has to be spelled out. It has to reflect what the National Board calls a natural harvest of teacher work. That is, if we're going to ask teachers to compile a portfolio, it shouldn't be stuff they do only for that. It should, as I say, a natural harvest. So it'll almost and certainly include observations. I can't imagine a system of teacher evaluation that did not include observations of teacher teaching, you know, classroom practice. But I'll tell you something else. I can't imagine a good system that relied exclusively on observations of classroom practice for the simple reason that a lot of what's important about teaching doesn't happen in the classroom. It's behind the scenes work. It's the planning that John reminded us of yesterday. It's all the collaboration with colleagues and communicating with families and maintaining records, all the stuff that in my framework is in domain four. So a comprehensive system has to accommodate all of that. We need trained evaluators who can make consistent judgments based on evidence. Now, this turns out to be harder than any of us ever thought. And as I guess Steve yesterday reminded us, and it's just a reminder because we all know it, that my evaluation as a teacher shouldn't depend on which one of you is evaluating me. And you know what? It's not enough to go to training. That's what we've had to discover somewhat recently. It's not enough to go to training. What's essential is that anybody doing evaluations have demonstrated that they can do it accurately and consistently. And so I'm actually in the middle of some development work with TeachScape right now to try to design such a procedure to offer such assurance. And it makes only common sense. When representatives of a teachers union say, and they object to some detail of a teacher evaluation system because they say, my principal doesn't know what he's talking about, they actually have a point. I mean, they do. They might be right on that. And so it seems to me it's absolutely essential for the credibility and the validity of the system as a whole that we be able to offer that assurance. And so we are working on that right now. It turns out, of course, like everything else in the world, not to be simple. But we're optimistic, and we're pretty far down the track of getting it designed. And we will be looking for sort of advisors on this. So if you have really a keen interest in this aspect of teacher evaluation, do be in touch, because it is important. And we're putting together a small advisory group just to, you know, explore questions related to it with. Okay, so that's the training issue. Then, of course, you need PD for teachers so they understand the evaluative criteria and the process and the whole thing. That's not minor. It's not minor. It needs to be well-designed. It needs to... And if you're a large place, that's a really significant design challenge. Almost certainly involves online stuff. Perhaps trained facilitators. I'm not sure all the solutions to it, but it's complex and essential. You don't want people like I was, who, you know, doing my little clay boats, and somebody says, well, that's not teaching, you know. And then you need a process for making a final judgment. Now, this is worth a sentence or two. Let's suppose you're an evaluator and you've observed a teacher's practice in a whole bunch of areas, in their classroom, on informal, formal observations, their conduct in the corridor, interacting with students, with other teachers, in the faculty room, there you see what they do with parents, you may get phone calls from parents. You have, in the end, essentially, a lot of data points, right, on which to make a judgment. And so, how do you do that? And are some of them more important than others? Almost certainly, yes. Well, in that case, which ones, right? But there's another issue as well, and that is, and the measurement people, they refer to this as score combining, score combining is the process. They also refer to this other thing as compensation. It's got nothing to do with money. The question it's answering is this: if a teacher is really good in some aspect of practice, does that compensate for poor performance somewhere else, or no? That's a judgment. That's a decision to make. There's no right or wrong answer to it, right? So that last bullet up there about how do you arrive at a judgment given a lot of data points is worthy of some serious thought and discussion, and probably looking at some, you know, profiles of different teachers and so on. Again, no magic here. And as far as I know, I don't know anybody who's got a formula or an algorithm for this. And then when you throw in student learning on top of it, it gets complicated pretty quickly. And when I see these things from some states that say, well, 53% of our evaluation of teachers will be, depend on their student learning, what that says to me is that somebody envisions a formula that goes something like 0.53 times something plus 0.47 times something else gives you something. Now, I don't have a clue what goes into any of those terms. And I hope somebody's working on that, because I don't think any of us knows, actually. If you figured it out, do let me know. I'd really like to know. Okay, so here we are, quality assurance. Now, one of the frameworks that's been used for understanding good teaching is my framework for teaching. And what I did was take the complex work of teaching, divide it up into these four major domains. Now, when we do training, by the way, we put out a question like this, like, if you were to walk into a classroom, what might you see or hear there that would convince you you're in the presence of an expert? Right? What would cause you to think, oh, whoa, this is good. If I had a kid this age, I'd want him right here. Well, most people come up with student engagement pretty early. And that's great. But then that takes a little unpacking, too, because when people say student engagement, I have to assume they don't just mean busy, right? They mean something else. Well, then how do you know that it's something else? So it's related, and John mentioned this yesterday, to great effect of that it has to do not only with that the kids are doing things. What is it that they're doing? And remember earlier I said about learning being done by the learner through an active intellectual process. Are they actively intellectually engaged? What's the nature of the task we're asking of them? And so we can observe, and we can listen in on kids' conversations, and we can talk to them if we can do it, without disrupting the class. But even something like student engagement is not just a matter of a quick look. We need to know more. So anyway, in the framework, each of these four domains is broken up into five or six smaller components. And I'll just say a couple of words about this. First of all, it's a framework for teaching, not a framework for school nurses, librarians, the other psychologists, right, counselors. Those individuals who hold those positions, and they're important ones, they are typically in the teacher bargaining unit, but the jobs are different. The jobs are really different. And so in the second edition of the framework book, I have a chapter on that offers frameworks for those non-classroom specialist positions in schools. And I consider it a first draft. I hope that if you choose to use those, you would feel free to make modifications, because in truth, those positions are actually quite different from one school to the next. And I've never done any of them. And so I don't have the same confidence with what I offered there as I do for the teacher. But I think it's a good start. I drew on the professional organizations of all those groups and then put them into a similar framework as this. That is, there's something in each of them called planning and preparation. There's something called the environment. It might be the library, the nurse's office, right, the counselor's room. There's something, instead of instruction, it's called delivery of service or something. And that, of course, that's where the big differences are from teaching. And then there's something called professional responsibilities, which tends to be pretty similar to that of teachers. So I just want to let you know that's available. Okay. Framework for teaching. It is research-based. Every item up here has got a good solid base foundation, research foundation. In fact, that's the title of the last chapter of the book, or the appendix, the research foundation, which I did update for the second edition. I guess, let me mention one other thing here. I would not want you to think that I think that because these aspects of teaching are listed separately and described separately, I wouldn't want you to think that I think that teachers do them separately. I know much better than that. Teaching is very intertwined and tangled. And in fact, it's an interesting exercise to explore that question and to take any one of these, let's say questioning and discussion skills. Does this work? Anyway, I don't know if it's working or not, but the questioning discussion skills is the second one under domain 3, 3B. Now, if a teacher were really good at that, What else in this framework would that same teacher have to be good at also in order to be good at questioning and discussion techniques? Right? Have to know their content, definitely. Like to know what is an important question or to recognize an important question if a student asks it. You have to know your kids. What's an appropriately challenging question for this group or this individual? Have to have clear outcomes, right? Where do I want this discussion to go? What am I hoping the kids will learn from it? Over in domain two, there will be several things. Respect and rapport, you want it to be a safe place for kids to take a risk, right? Procedures, do you raise your hand, do you not, and so on. So you get the idea here. So then you might ask reasonably, well, if it's so entangled, then what is to be gained by listing all these things out separately? I think the best answer to that question is by an analogy with a theater in the round. Now think of a theater in the round. You've got the play. Think of that as the lesson. It's not a perfect analogy, but it's good for this. Here's the lesson, or the play. Now, this is a theater in the round, so the audience is sitting all around, right? And because the audience is sitting all around, the lights have to come from all directions. I think of these things like the lights. Here's a lesson, but let's just focus on the questioning skills, or on the interactions, or on the procedures, right? And so if you think of it that way, then this framework for teaching is actually an analytic tool. And in some respects, that's all it is. That's all it is. Useful one, but let's not make, you know, huge claims for it because of the complexity and the intertwinedness of teaching. Now, I did say a minute ago that that these are all research-based, and they are also, they're not rocket science, and I really believe that. I'm honored when people find it useful, frankly, because I was not setting out to do anything creative or original. I was trying to be clear. And to be able to put on one page without trivializing the complex work of teaching, but something manageable. In fact, I sort of thought after I wrote this book, God, I wish I had this when I was first teaching. It would have helped. And might have had an answer to that principle, right? But there is one item in the framework that is unusual, and I'd just like to spend 2 sentences on it. It's in domain two. It's the second one, the culture for learning. Now, here's what it's grounded on. I'll just give you a tiny little anecdote. I was once in a high school doing a workshop in student assessment. Right? And we were in the library. It was a nice room, like round tables and chairs. It was a good, nice environment. And on one wall were photographs of students, one a year. And it must have gone back 25 years. And it said, athlete of the year. Well, don't get me wrong. I have nothing against sports. I know this is why some kids come to school. I know in some towns, the Friday night game brings the entire community together. In my own personal life, one of my own kids is a world-level competitor, or was. I mean, that's pretty cool. You go to somewhere and they say, representing the United States, you know, that's very cool for a kid. It's actually pretty cool for the kid's mother. But I'm sure you can hear there's a big but lurking in here. And it's this. We were meeting this group, and I said, you know, I admired their photographs. I said, that's very attractive. That's really neat. I said, but I'm curious. Where do you have the poet of the year? Where have you got the inventor of the year or whatever, right? I mean, and when you designate the poet of the year, maybe you should hang them in the gym. I mean, it's just a thought. Got the athletes in the library, right? Now, I'm not naive. I know that we live in a celebrity culture, and who are our celebrities? They're not the poets. They're the athletes and the entertainers, right? But you know something? If we can't have a culture for learning in a school, where on earth would we have it? And so this is grounded in the notion that there are some, among some students, in many schools, particularly middle schools and high schools, there's a culture among the students that it's not cool to be smart. It's not cool to work. It's not cool to care. I think until we can really solve that problem, we almost might as well go home. Because remember what I said a minute ago, learning is done by the learner. If the kids aren't committed to this, we can't do it for them. We have to engineer the environment so they do care. Now that's a challenge. And I hope some of you all have figured it out, because I don't have any magic to it. I mean, but I know we need to do it. Okay, let me just get back to this one second. We'll say one more thing. Sometimes people look at this and they say, well, it's fine so far as it goes, but it is missing a few things. What about, like, technology? Is that gone missing? What about high expectations? Where's that? Ton of research. There are some items that I called common themes, and these are they. There are seven of them. There may be more, actually, but I know there are these seven that are, they're not included as components of teaching, not because they're not important. They are. They are not included because they don't refer to what teachers do in their teaching, which is what these are. They refer instead to the manner in which they do them. So let's imagine I'm a teacher and I hold high expectations for student learning. Those high expectations will be reflected in the outcomes I set. They'll be set at a high and demanding, challenging level. At the questions I pose, they'll be at a high cognitive level. At the feedback I give to kids, it will be on the assumption of high-level learning. With the communication with family, I mean, sure, you get the idea here, right? And so these common themes are pervasive through the framework. And it's an interesting conversation to have with teachers and ask which ones of the common themes apply to which ones of the components. They all apply to more than one. None of them, I don't think, applies to all. And the interesting question is not which ones apply to which, but how. Exactly how is it that high expectations plays out in the different ones where it does apply? So those are interesting conversations. Now, the other thing I need to say here, sort of in general, is that for each of the components, there's a narrative description and so on. And that's important, by the way. Some districts use my stuff and they sort of neglect to have people actually read it. But there's a lot of stuff. I mean, I'm serious. I learned a lot from John's presentation yesterday because he reminded us of the complexity of this work and the importance of contextual factors in understanding what we see, and he had his long list of things, a ton of things on that list, but they came to life when he described them. And the same thing with these things. You can read these and you say, tick, 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 you know, but no, what do we actually mean by, let's say, even something sort of simple like clear routines and procedures? What does that actually look like? What does that include? Why is it important? And so on. So, and for each of the components, then, there is a chart, a rubric that looks like this. Now, I realize you can't read this. That's by design. It's a ploy so you'll buy the book. This one happens to be 2A, which is creating an environment of respect and rapport. There are two critical elements, teacher interaction with students and student interaction with each other. And what I did was just describe in pretty simple language for each of the elements, what it looks like at four levels of performance: unsatisfactory, basic, proficient, and distinguished. And what I'd like to do is say a couple of words about these levels of performance, because some of this isn't even in the book. But it's really important, and I'd like to just spend a minute here. And I'll start with unsatisfactory. Now, I don't know if any of you has had experience in the licensing world. But there's a concept in licensing, which is actually, it's sort of an odd concept, but useful, called do no harm. Okay? And it pertains to anything for which there's a license, right? I mean, we can drive our car across the bridge, and unless we're in Minneapolis, we can be pretty sure it won't collapse under us because it was designed by a licensed engineer. This building probably won't fall down. It was designed by a licensed architect. I mean, that's what the license means. It's the state's guarantee to the public, unwitting public, in this case us, that we will not come to harm as a consequence of this person's work. Now, there is nothing in the licensing procedure for architects that says that the building must be beautiful, as is evident if you look around you. There are plenty of ugly buildings, right? It's got nothing to do with aesthetics. It's merely safety. That's what a license teaches, right? It's the state's guarantee to the public that children, students, will not come to harm in this person's classroom. I wrote the statements in unsatisfactory deliberately to be below that standard. There's harm being done, or very close to it, or learning is being shut down, or the environment is chaotic, or whatever, right? And so, which has an interesting and important consequence, that if you have an administrative position, supervisory responsibilities of any kind, if you encounter teacher performance at that level, in my view, that's intervention time, because we can't permit harm being done to kids. That's our first obligation. So that usually means we have to address something rather promptly. Okay? But now, so there should be a thick line, really, between unsatisfactory and basic, and everything to the right of the line is degrees of good. Now, they reflect, first of all, these are levels of performance of teaching, not of teachers. It's an important distinction, right? Because you can look at a lesson and see characteristics like evidence of these different levels, and they might be different in a lesson tomorrow, okay? And so it's about what happens. Basic level performance, though, is the sort of teacher practice that is typical and characteristic of beginning teachers, student teachers, people who are new to the profession, who are doing everything more or less by definition for the first time. And so guess what? It's rough, inconsistent. Things don't go smoothly. I mean, that's the nature of it. And because they have no repertoire. They have no, something doesn't go well and they just have to soldier on because they don't have a plan B. This goes on all day long with beginning teachers. In my view, the first couple of years, and I'm not alone in this, the first couple of years of teaching is part of the learning to teach, which is, in my view, an argument for a good mentoring program. Because we want to help people get through this as quickly as possible, giving them the support they need to understand. And a tool like this is pretty useful for, because you can read what it says in basic and then your eye drifts to the right, and you say, oh, I can do that. You know, oh, and I see what you mean, that kind of conversation. So anyway, that's what basic is. Now, proficient level performance is good teaching. This is, and I should not use a value-laden word like that, but it is practice that is typical of experienced professional educators who know their students, or typical 14-year-olds, or whatever. They know their curriculum. They have a repertoire of strategies. They've got a lot of materials. They have eyes in the backs of their heads. They know how decisions are made in the school and how to get materials and all that stuff about, they know in the faculty lounge, don't sit in that chair because that's Mrs. Jones's and she'll eat you for lunch. All this stuff around the school, right? They know how to do parent conferences, all that. So, okay, that's proficient. So then you might say, well, what's distinguished? Distinguished level performance is qualitatively different. In the classroom functioning at a distinguished level, it almost appears that the teacher's not doing much, that the class is sort of running itself, that the students themselves have taken a lot of responsibility for what goes on there, and they make sure it works. And so it's important when people use this rubric, they actually make some people rather uncomfortable because they're used to being at the top of whatever the scale is. And then somebody offers them a rating scale that actually the highest level is pretty rare. And in fact, as one of my colleagues says, it's a nice place to visit, but don't expect to live there. And I think that's good advice, right? So distinguished level performance is very high level practice. It is higher actually than what would get you national board certification. It's very, very high. All the common themes that are appropriate to that component play out and so on. So it's very high level performance. Now, here's a caution I have for you. Let's just think of a few scenarios. You are more likely to observe, or if you're a teacher, you're more likely to exhibit high level, that is proficient, distinguished performance in May than you would have been in September. And it takes a while to sort of get it going with a class. But let's play out another little scenario. Let's suppose I'm a fifth grade teacher. I've been teaching fifth grade for 10 years or 15 years. I'm good. I'm experienced, I know what I'm about. Next year, I'm assigned a second grade class. Oh boy. Oh, and I need to add one more thing on my fifth graders. I'm skilled at that, and I perform pretty regularly at a proficient, high-level proficient, maybe distinguished level, especially, and I hesitate to say this, but I think we have to acknowledge it, especially if there's a particular two kids who are absent. We should not pretend this isn't true. There are some kids who come into school bringing enormous burdens with them, and it makes it for a challenge for us. So, but let's leave that aside, but let's not pretend it's not true. But let's get back now. I'm assigned a second grade class. Oh boy. I don't know that curriculum. I don't know how seven-year-olds think. I don't know their sense of humor. I hardly have any knock-knock jokes. Like, I have work to do. I've got work to do before I'm going to be as good at second grade as I would have been had I stayed at fifth. And in fact, I'm probably going to perform at a basic level for at least a while, for the same reason a new teacher would. Well, I am, in fact, a new teacher in second grade, right? So, and I'll probably move up more quickly and so on, but I'm not going to start off good. But we need to think through what this means. And I implore you that, and it's tempting to take this or something like it and say, oh, okay, there's 22 components, there's four levels, let's call them 1, 2, 3, 4, let's evaluate performance, multiply by 22, or divide by 22, and anything above a 2.75 or something is good for tenure. I beg you not to do that. These are not equidistant points on a psychometric scale. You maybe could add them. National Board, after all, does add. But you cannot multiply and divide them. I mean, it just simply doesn't work. And so I just implore you not to. Don't be even tempted. And so where this is most powerful is as a tool for conversation. And this is what we've discovered, my little Danielson group and I, we do training, a lot of training, and we keep hearing the same thing over and over again, which is, it's all about the conversation. Like a teacher and a principal will have a session, they'll talk together after a lesson they've observed, and they'll both report similar things, a little different language because they have a little different perspective, but they'll say things like, we had a great conversation, the first time ever. And so that's another little application here. If you use this for evaluation, something like this, usually there's a planning conference, there's an observation, and then there's a reflection. I call it a reflection conference. If you have to cut some corners, please don't cut the conferences. Please don't cut the... That's where the real value is. Because, you see, we've always known that teaching is demanding physical work. Teachers are up and down the stairs and up and down off the floor if they're primary often. So you're tired at the end of the day, right? We've always known that it's demanding emotional work. And the more caring a person is, I'm pretty sure the more demanding. But here's what we've learned a little bit more recently, is that teaching is also challenging intellectual work. That teachers make hundreds, literally, people have counted this, hundreds of decisions a day, often under what we would have to call unfavorable circumstances, like in a hurry, based on incomplete information, right? You don't know how many kids are going to be absent. And so, in other words, teaching is a thinking person's job. It's a thinking person's job. And so what that then means is that if we accept, and I really think we have to, that teaching is, among other things, cognitive work, then the conversations we have about teaching must be about the cognition. Which is why the conferences are critical. That's where you, and we had a brilliant example of that yesterday about respiration. Who knew? Happens in every cell. I wanted to ask that teacher, what about my fingernails? but I didn't have that opportunity. But I would have wanted to, right? That's where the value is for teachers, is in the conversation. So please don't shortchange it. And I know it's tempting to, because it does actually take time. But I would argue that it's the most valuable part of it. So there's some features of this framework, and I've talked about most of these. It's comprehensive. I try to describe all of teaching. It's grounded in research, of course. Public, critical, not like my little guy with the clay boats. coherent, generic. There's only one framework. There's not a different one for middle school science and high school English, right? It's one. But we know that teaching is extremely contextualized. We know that the manner in which a high school teacher will establish an environment of respect and rapport for in the classroom is very different from what a kindergarten teacher does. The behavior, that the underlying structure is the same. That is, it's a safe environment for risk-taking and so on for kids. But this is not a checklist of specific behaviors. It cannot be because the behaviors themselves are different. Some people try to turn it into a checklist, by the way, and I've been resisting that. But just so you know, it's as we know, teaching is so contextualized that we always have to interpret, as we did yesterday watching John's video clips. You know, that little exchange with the student who was had given an incomplete response. How the teacher handled that, there was a lot going on there, and you could identify the bits of what was going on there against the framework. About content accuracy, about honoring the student, about requiring that the student come up with a complete response and so on, and academically accurate. A lot going on there. So we know teaching is very contextualized. But the framework itself is generic because the real work then comes is interpreting it in different contexts. And that's fun work to do. That's what teachers should do. In fact, I very early on when the framework was out, was doing a workshop, and a teacher raised their hand and questioned and said, are you thinking of doing one of these for middle school science? And I said, well, actually, I'm not. First of all, I don't know enough about middle school science, but more importantly, that's what you should do, you and your colleagues. Figure out what it means for you. Okay? So, okay, generic, coherent. And it is independent of any particular teaching methodology, and I'll just say two sentences on this. We are, in case you've not noticed, a rather faddish profession. Like, initiatives come and go, and actually, they never seem to go, do they? I mean, they just come. And we've had a lot of them. I mean, we've had, you know, like cooperative learning, and learning styles, and multiple intelligences, and et cetera, right? Differentiation. And I'm not knocking these things, they're good. We can learn from them. But we also have to, I mean, they can sort of be seductive, too. I mean, and we have to look out for that. I can go to a workshop or read a book or something on cooperative learning and think, oh, this is great. I should be doing everything this way. And actually, no. That is, I don't know about you. I've been in plenty of classes where students are working in groups and they are learning nothing. They're sharing their ignorance. Right? I mean, it's not that cooperative learning is or is not a powerful strategy. Of course it is. That's not the right question. The question is, under what conditions, for what purposes, is it a good choice? Which is why people need a repertoire. Okay. And so then that becomes then the conversation. How did you decide to do it this way rather than that way? And explore options. Because remembering that teaching is a cognitive activity. And I've heard actually a number of definitions of professionalism. One that I really like that I think applies well to teaching is that professionalism involves complex decision making under conditions of uncertainty. That would be teaching. That would definitely be teaching. So, so a couple more little items here. Let's talk for just a second about professional learning. And just a couple statements here. Ongoing professional learning is essential. That professional learning is not an add-on to the work of teaching. No, it's integral to the work, right? It's integral to it. It's part of being a teacher, which is why a culture in the school for inquiry, a culture of professional inquiry, is vital to a faculty moving forward. And I'm not being critical of teacher preparation programs. Some are better than others, obviously, but that's not where the problem is. The problem is that some of us in schools, and some people in very high-level policy positions, I will add, seem to believe that once you've got your degree, you're done. I actually had an assistant superintendent once who thought that I was the curriculum director, and I thought, really? No, like not. But that is still a mentality some places. So I urge you to work on that. But that has to get right into the school, that ongoing professional learning is part of the work, and the framework can be a vehicle for that. So what are the components then that we know of professional learning? Well, first of all, an environment of trust. Now, it sounds obvious to say that, but let's just remember that fear shuts people down, period. Which is why it is very challenging, I won't say impossible, it is challenging to have an evaluation system that also really promotes learning because, especially for probationary teachers, it is not a safe environment. They are vulnerable and they know it. Which is why then for probationary teachers, often the more trusting and therefore the best potential for learning for them is with their mentor. Another argument for a mentoring program. Now, certainly the evaluation system for all teachers, including probationary teachers, can promote learning if it includes these things: self-assessment, reflection on practice, and professional conversation. And I'll just mention on reflection on practice, there's been a lot of research on reflection, as you're probably aware. It's not a new idea. I mean, John Dewey, in over 100 years ago, pointed out that it's not so much that we learn from what we do, we learn from how we think about what we do, and it's the thinking that matters. Human beings are quite capable of doing the same wrong thing over and over again. We've got plenty of evidence of that. Right? Have you ever noticed John Dewey's actually looking better all the time? He really is. Anyway, professional conversation and also, come on. Oh, I pushed the wrong button. You see, an infusion of expertise. Let's remember, too, that we can establish PLCs and hope for some good learning, but you know, if nobody actually knows anything in that group, I mean, honestly, we can talk about the Friday night game all day, or we can talk about a student we're concerned about, but unless we have some infusion of expertise somehow, either from one of us who's expert, or we read an article, or somebody brings us some, right? So just don't forget about expertise. And then structures to support professional learning. And that mostly boils down to time. But it also might include, and it gets expensive, people like instructional coaches. That's where the value is. Master teachers, people whose job it is to keep those conversations going. So I'll just close then with how does the framework offer this? First of all, the framework offers a common language. Now, we learned this about 100 years ago from Madeline Hunter. The value of it, that was the first glimpse any of us had that, oh, yeah, teaching actually, we do have a knowledge base. We are a profession. There's a knowledge base that is shared by a community of professionals and that and that we can talk to each other. So common language is sort of the bedrock. But then, in addition, the framework offers this, this research-based definition, and it provides a coherent architecture. You know, I was working on a project some years ago, and we were trying to develop a teacher development, our teacher evaluation system assessment, high stakes, by the way, for licensing. We were admiring the work that had been done previously in Louisiana. They had done a very nice job of defining good teaching, but their system had 145 separate things. And we said, oh man, you know, I don't know if I could hang on to that. And we actually did a little research. What is the maximum number of items that a human being can hold in their head at once? The answer is 8. So 145 was clearly off the charts. So we said something to the folks from Louisiana about this, and they said, yeah, we've been hearing that from other people. So they simplified it, and they got it down to 121. Which was a start. But what I did with the framework is to organize it into 4 big ideas, right? And then each one into 5 or 6. And I think that makes it actually easy to use because you can sort of, you know where you are in it. And then it offers a roadmap to this complex territory. I mean, none of this is, as I said before, rocket science. It defines the development of expertise. Those rubrics describe both experience and expertise from one level to the next. That's what they try to do, at least. So they give people something to sort of think about and look at and consider and talk about. And then lastly, it offers a structure for exactly those things that we know from the research: promote learning, self-assessment, reflection on practice, and professional conversation. And at the same time, it can be used to evaluate. So there you go. I appreciate your attention, and I think we might even have a minute or two for questions, do we? Yeah. So I wasn't sure how long any of this would take, so I'm glad that we have a little time. So let's open it up. Thoughts? Questions. I know, I hate to stay be between people and their coffee, although actually it's not break time, is it? So, oh, go ahead. I'm sorry, which one? Oh, the common themes? Sure. I just have to go back. Oh, missed them. Those. Yeah, common themes. These are all reflected in the high levels of performance, proficient and particularly distinguished level of practice. And they all apply to various ones of the components. Yeah. Let's have a good hard question. You see one? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead. Right. The natural act of helping people improve, it appears to me that I would want to advocate for more study of the observation, more analysis okay. on part of the
of the teacher.
Because I think they make those decisions very quickly.
Right.
About a 20-minute yeah. observation, and this is too important.
It is. Let me try to repeat and tell me if I don't capture this right. She said, given what I had said about the importance of the conferencing, she would want to advocate for more and deeper analysis of the observation itself by the principal, whoever is the observer, because those are so often done on the fly. I would agree with that, and I'd like to actually add to it. And I'm probably going to say something that sounds just a little bit heretical. Here's how we normally do an observation. And it's sort of what I described a minute ago, right? You come to my class, you watch me teach, blah, blah, blah. It seems to me that we can make a small shift in that procedure and vastly improve its value. So let's start off the same. You come to my class, you watch me teach, you take notes, and you go away. But before you go away, or after, you give me a copy of your notes, if they're legible. That's my problem. But you give me a copy of your notes. But actually, even if you can't do that, it doesn't matter a lot, because I was actually there too. And so you go away and you don't exactly write up your notes, but you interpret your notes against the components of the framework. But before we meet, I do that too. I do that also. And now we talk. So now I'm involved in the self-assessment and reflection on practice, and we're about to have a conversation. And so I have to, this is the heretical part. I'm not a big fan of feedback, actually. Beginning teachers, yes. They need sort of affirmation that they're on the right track and all that. But here's how, unless you've figured out a way to do this better, the feedback that I see, it usually takes this form of, here's what I liked and I saw, here's what I think you should try differently, blah, blah, blah. That is, it feels to me actually rather patronizing to the teacher. What's better is a professional conversation, starting with what the teacher thought, and not just how did the lesson go? Oh, fine. No. The fundamental reflection question is always the same. If you had a chance to do this again, would you do it the same or would you do it differently? The sort of right answer to that question is almost always, I'd do it a little differently. That is, now I realize that the directions for that activity weren't really clear, or, you know, whatever, right? that I don't think I'll, when I group the kids, I wasn't thinking straight, I don't think I'll put those two kids together again. I mean, all kinds of things, that is, there are a ton of instructional decisions that are made in designing a lesson. They are all subject to revision. And so I think the feedback from the observer it's on almost towards the bottom of my list of what ought to happen in that conference. So it should be an analysis of it by both, actually, in my view, the teacher and the observer. And now, in the end, if this really is evaluation, the buck does stop with the administrator. And and if there's a difference of opinion, that's the one that matters. But it shouldn't. The buck does have to stop there, but it doesn't have to start there. And I really see it as a professional conversation and a dialogue. Do you want to supplement?
To follow up on that.
Okay.
Let's say that I, the observer, had mastered the entire, which is a big if, that I have mastered the entire
framework.
And I how many times is it reasonable to think I would need to come into the classroom to even make that?
Okay. Yeah, question was, there are 10 components that are visible in the classroom. That is, let's just back up here a second. They're the domains 2 and 3, okay? And a little bit of domain 1 in terms of content knowledge. And so her question is, let's suppose she knows this framework pretty well, and that's not an unreasonable assumption. I mean, that's called training, 3 days or so. But it's not impossible. So you learn, and that's, by the way, how to actually observe and sort of interpret your observations for 3 days. But let's suppose you've done that. And so the question really was, how many times would you have to be in a classroom to sort of see all those things? Well, it sort of depends, obviously, on the kind of lesson it is. If they're showing a video, you know, like a lot, like infinite number. But a normal classroom, you see most of them in 2 and 3, not all. You notice the last thing under 3 in domain 3 is demonstrating flexibility and responsiveness. That has to do with making adjustments when you have to. Sometimes a lesson doesn't need that, and so you just simply don't see it. But most of the others you do see some way or other in most lessons, but not quite always. Okay, you're standing by a mic. Go ahead.
Hey, Charlotte. John Barker from Memphis. We're doing a pilot and looking at 3 different observation rubrics, yours being one of them, the DC impact being another, and TAP being the third. What do you think your prediction would be as we roll these out with our teachers and the application and the feedback that we'll get from teachers who are ultimately in the position of basically deciding which one we go with going forward?
And what's the question exactly?
Well,
do I get to lobby?
Well, see, I was hoping it would be an open door opportunity, though. But let's do a little.
But by the way, I know there's people from TAP here, so I don't want to be rude.
No, sure.
And
sure,
I admire TAP actually.
Sure,
but go ahead.
And I think DC Impact has wiretapped the room. So.
Oh, okay.
But the issue being of those 3 and any of the others that are out there. You know, what do you see across, I mean, there's multiple observation instruments, yours being one of that pantheon, if you want to think about it like that. What's the, can you do compare, contrast, and which one's easier, which one's better, which one do you think teachers like better?
I really can't. And I don't think I mean, obviously I'm biased, right? And so anything I would say would have to be interpreted in that light. So I think, how to help you make that decision. It seems to me that it's all about utility. What's useful? What's comprehensible? What reflects our idea of what good teaching is? This framework is grounded in a view of learning that I said earlier about learning being done by the learner through an active intellect. Like intellectual engagement is at the heart of the framework. And so, I just don't know that for sure about the others. So that would be a question to, that is, one of the chapters in my book has to do with the assumptions underlying it. And I would urge you, as part of your process, whoever's deciding this, to actually take a look at that chapter, not just the stuff, but the chapter that describes the assumptions on which it is based. Because any description of teaching is grounded in some assumptions. They just aren't usually explicit, right?
I try to make them explicit because I recognize it's important. So that's how I would guide you in making that decision, is to read that chapter. And then for the others, if they don't actually aren't explicit about that, infer it from what that you do have. And that would be one big part of the decision, is does it reflect how we see learning and therefore teaching? And just so you know, I define teaching as that which causes learning. And so we have to really be clear about what is the learning we want, and that's usually in our curriculum standards, but then what are the skills that teachers need to ensure that learning, and what do we believe about the profession of teaching? And not only what's worth learning, but how is it that kids learn? And I try to be explicit about that. So that would be my recommendation for a process.
Thank you for your talk. Eric Anderson, Seattle Public Schools. We're going to be adopting your framework as part of our new evaluation system, and also aligning our mentoring and induction and professional development to that framework beginning this year in a part of a 3-year implementation rollout. My question is this, and when you were talking about the levels of unsatisfactory, basic, proficient, and the way you seemed to frame that was, is that unsatisfactory would basically be doing harm. Basic would be what you might expect an inexperienced teacher that's struggling to be at. But proficient, it seemed to be the implication, and then distinguished would be this relatively high bar.
Right.
But the implication of that to me is that there's sort of a built-in expectation that your typical veteran teacher is proficient. And what if you're concerned that the actual typical or median or mean level of performance in your district as a whole is actually not where you want it to be, and you want to raise that up? And so just that concern that having proficient be sort of this default position, that if you're a 6-year teacher, I'm going to walk in, I'm assuming you're proficient unless you prove otherwise. What if it were to reframe it as
I would not have that as your mindset.
Okay. I was just, you know, because how can you possibly reframe that so that you make proficient itself and actually quite a high bar, so that the teaching and learning process that's associated with the framework stimulates and incentivizes teachers to work to reach not just distinguished but proficiency.
If I'm understanding your question, let me try answering it and then correct me if I've missed something important. The reason there are words here and not just numbers or letters or something is that let's say you come into a classroom and you observe it, and you then have to interpret, you have to then interpret what you've seen against these levels. Now, what you see is what you see. I mean, it's things that happen. It's the evidence. It's what people do, what they say, the look of the classroom, the sort of the energy level and all this. It's what the kids are doing and what the teacher is, how the teacher's responding, et cetera. We can agree on what happened in a class. Let's say I'm the teacher. You've taken your notes. We can agree on what happened. The question is, what does that mean? How do those events, how are they interpreted against this language? Which of these little groups of words up here best characterizes what we saw, or what you saw? And that's the interpretation. But I wouldn't go into a classroom with any kind of default judgment in mind, because it really is evidence-based. It has to be. That's why they're words. Now, I'll tell you something we've run into, though, which is a very interesting, and it's a little hard to know exactly how to address it except through a lot of training and conversation. We've been working in a lot of school districts, and in some cases, the principals will see a lesson, and it may be better than anything they've ever seen before, and they'll say, distinguished. And actually, if you analyze even their notes, it's not. But they don't have a mental picture of what distinguished practice looks like, which is another reason we're working with Teachscape to try to capture some of that and offer the models, so people have a visual and an interpreted vision of what that is. But I think it has to be evidence-based.
Thank you.
I am Janet Silverthorne, District of Columbia Public Schools. My concern about the evaluation is that oftentimes, it doesn't seem to me that there is a place for the student's voice in the whole evaluation and observation process. Okay. Is there a place for that?
There is, and I'm really glad you raised that issue. Because, actually, if you look at even this one, you probably can't read it, of course, so you'll buy the book. Up in the distinguished level for the first one, the teacher interaction with students, it says students, students demonstrate genuine caring for one another and monitor one another's treatment of peers. That is, in the distinguished level descriptors, there's an important role for students and student voice. And I would also just add to that, that the framework itself describes the work of teaching, but often in many, many of the components, the evidence for whether that work is well done is by what the students do. That's the evidence. And it's grounded in this view of learning about active learning, intellectual engagement, and so on. And so in many of the components, for example, organizing physical space, the highest level performance there is that the kids themselves take some responsibility for that. And if there's a noise in the hall, the kid gets up and shuts the door, for example. That is, they own that classroom, and they make it work. So let's remember, though, that in school, we are the adults. We decide what we want kids to learn. It's not a free-for-all. This is not Summerhill, right? But every one of the kids in that classroom is an individual with his and her own interests, passions, ambitions, fears. They're people. And they're smaller than adults, but they're no less people. And so so much of teaching hinges on those interactions and that respect of them as people. So that's a wonderful question about the voice, and I think we have to be mindful of what I mean by that is that a mark of excellent teaching is that the students are not only treated with respect, but they are given the opportunity to contribute to the functioning of the class. Okay? So I hope that sort of satisfies you as an answer. Okay, then I'll leave it there. Oh, I just saw a sign that says no time left. So I guess that's going to do it. Well, thank you so much for your attention this morning. Thank you.